understand the purpose over here for vManage, right? You guys understand the purpose of VBOND? Purpose, not how it's configured. You understand the purpose of vSmart. And you guys have the WAN edges over here. That's what I wanted to get out of here with this particular stuff. Now you have the MPLS, the internet, and the cellular in the middle. It can be any type of communication. All I need is IP reachability. What protocol can I provide to provide reachability from here to here over MPLS, internet, or cellular? I can do static routes, I can do BGP, I can do ISIS, whatever protocol you want, you can run as long as I have IP reachability from the controllers to your edges. Everybody okay with that? All right, brilliant. So this is what I want you guys to know at this point. The next thing, let's go a little deeper into each one of those devices and let's focus on that. First one is your vManage. vManage is not a physical appliance. vManage is a VM. Understood? vManage is a VM. Where can you install it? You can install it within your own company. You can install it on the cloud. Everybody okay with that? So when you install it, there is no physical appliance called the vManage. It's a VM that you install. So because it's a VM, you can install it anywhere you want. As long as there's reachability, IP reachability, you can put it anywhere you want. All your configurations for the entire SD-WAN setup. SD-WAN setup is done through vManage, which includes configuration of your devices. So interface configuration of the devices over here, the routing protocol that you're going to run internally or on the towards MPLS or the internet, all configured from where? From vManage. What does vManage use to propagate these route, this configuration down over here? It's the NetConf API. The tunnel that it uses to send NetConf configuration across is DTLS. All right, so central provisioning means what? I'm actually bringing the device up from a central location. I'm configuring the device from a central location. What does this configuration look like? What am I doing in terms of configuration over here? Configuring the interface IP over here. Configuring the routing protocol that I'm going to run with MPLS over here. Maybe a static default route towards the internet. Normal configuration that you would do on the router, you do it from where? From vManage. For how many devices? The entire SD-WAN setup. So what 20, 30 people would take to do that job, especially for a remote site? Now you can do it centrally using a single person or maybe a couple of people for backup. Not only that, the policies, which is a very, very, this is basically the strong point of SD-WAN. Number one is the templates. Templates are basically what I was just talking about, configuration of these devices, all done centrally from where? From vManage. The other thing is policies. What is a policy? Let me explain that over here, guys. Looking at this picture over here, how many sites do you guys see? Yeah, there. You need to take a look at the data sheet for that. Yes, there is. In terms of the number of vManage device should handle versus a cluster. So you have five sites, right? You have the Dubai site, which has a data center network over here. And then you have sites over here. Clear? Now, based on our conversation earlier on, my routing updates using OMP are going to go where? My name relationship for OMP is going to be set up between what? Everyone and vSmart. Agreed? Yeah? vSmart takes that relationship and propagates those routes to whom? To the edge to edge. So far, so good? So when I go on to, let's say this guy over here, let's say this guy in Los Angeles, the site, and I see a network like 172.16.41.0/24 via, what will it say for a via? Keep it simple right now, I'll say Rome, right? The actual address I'll show you later on. Agreed? And if it wants to go to London, 31.0, it'll say via London. So how does LA go to Rome or to London? Does it go via vSmart? It has multiple different ways of going there. These are your transports. It'll go like that, or it might go like this. Agreed? So it goes to the MPLS cloud or the internet and makes reach, or takes reachability towards the other edge. You don't set up any control plane between the WAN edges, as I explained earlier. So all the control plane tunnels are towards the vSmart. But vSmart is just a control plane. It will not be part of the data plane. So the data plane goes direct. Clear so far? The next thing I want you guys to think about is, let's say for some reason, I want traffic to go through my data center because I might have a firewall that I want to run through. I want to control what traffic goes between these devices over here. As I've said earlier on as well. If the hub HQ goes down, HQ site goes down, yes, you would still have reachability from here to here. That is correct. So let's take a look at an example over here. Let's say for whatever reason, I want traffic to be routed through VEdge, any traffic from LA to London, to Rome, the sites that I have, or New Delhi. Any of those sites, if they want to go to each other, I want traffic to be run from the data center. I want to do hub and spoke. This is hub and spoke, if I want to do that. So basically what I want the vSmart to do is, when it receives a route from New Delhi, Rome, London, and LA, rather than keeping the next stop, I change the next stop to Dubai's next stop. So what I want to do is a hub and spoke type of setup where all the traffic from the spokes, from these remote sites, should go through Dubai. As an example, I'm just giving you an example. I configure a policy on vManager, and on vManager, I'll push that policy to vSmart. vSmart will make the changes in terms of the next stop. Now, LA, London, Rome, and New Delhi, to reach each other, their next stops will be what? Dubai. You understand that? With a matter of 2 minutes, I can change the topology. That is done through these things known as centralized policies. My main objective is to show you that you have the ability to traffic in a central location by just configuring the vSmart, vManage sends the centralized policies to the vSmart to change the OMP. Absolutely correct. So again, I'm not doing that change myself. I'm just configuring the change on vManage. vManage pushes that change to vSmart. vSmart changes OMP, the characteristic of OMP. So now, LA, London, Rome, and New Delhi, within a matter of minutes, will change the traffic and go through Dubai. Notice though, the traffic, the data plane, is still not coming through the vSmart. It is hub and spoke, but not hub and spoke from the perspective of vSmart. You get my point? It is hub and spoke to the vEdge of the central site. So again, even in this case, I'm not going through vSmart over here. And I'll show you how easy it is to do that. We'll be doing all these type of things for you guys. But I want you guys to get an idea of why SD-WAN. Why would I want to use SD-WAN over here? And the ease of the way you do it is unbelievable. I love DMVPN. I've been doing DMVPN since God knows when. I don't even remember now. But after working with SD-WAN, it is fabulous the way it does it. Now, the other thing I want to show you as an advantage of the policies, again, control where. All these policies are controlled in a central location. What is that central location? vManage in conjunction with what? vSmart, right? vManage is the configurer. vSmart is the implementer. Now, one of the things that you need to understand over here, I have two different transports on vEdge. We'll take a look at that. Let's focus on what I'm trying to say right now. When we do the actual implementation, those things will clear up. So another thing that I want you guys to think about over here, I want to go from VH2 to VH3. All right? Now, how does VH2 communicate to VH3? How many different ways does VH2 have to communicate to VH3? Looking at this topology over here. It has two different ways, right? The MPLS and the internet. Agreed? Now, if I have MPLS and VH, I have a network, 192.168.31.0. How do I reach it from LA? I reach it through my MPLS link. Oh, actually, before that, I need to reach, I need to go through London. Agreed? I need to go through London to reach that those two networks. Agreed? And what are the different ways for VH2 to reach VH3? Those are the MPLS and the internet. Agreed? By default, because my next hop is not the MPLS cloud or the internet, my next hop is VH3, and I have two different ways of doing it. It will use MPLS and the internet in a load balancing mechanism. So it's going to send one flow like this, and another flow like that. By default, between the two transports, the WAN edge does ECMP. By default. So any traffic that goes from VH2 to VH3 will be routed through MPLS, or it'll be routed through the internet cloud based on ECMP. So automatically, irrespective of the bandwidth, because my next stop is VH3. Good so far, guys? Now, let's say I was doing it based on normal routing today. Let's say I was doing it based on normal routing. How would I look at it? I would look at bandwidth, or I would put a preference like a cost from one to the other, and then choose a particular route to get to a particular destination. Isn't that true? No, they're on the same VRF. We'll talk about the specifics later on. They're in the same VRF, just to answer your question. So even if I didn't want to do this, this is not right. Why is it not right? Because one is better than the other. I want to prefer MPLS over the internet. Okay? How would I do it now? Let's say this was not a VH, this was a normal router. I would say in order to reach 172.16.31.0, the next hop should be the MPLS, right? Whether it's policy-based, whether you put a more specific route, whether you change the admin distance, different ways, but you're doing it route-based. Isn't that true, guys? For this particular destination, take that route. You might say, well, all the routes are going through MPLS. Let's say 31 and 32 is going through MPLS. Let's put 33 through the internet. So I'm doing some type of load sharing. So manually using a policy or maybe manipulating the routing protocol metric, I would do this. Isn't that true? Isn't that what you're doing right now with the metrics? So basically what you're doing is you're saying this network, this path, this network, that path, right? And you have redundancy. If one goes down, everything falls over to the other. That's the extent of policy-based routing that you can do. This is where SD-WAN takes it to a completely different level. The routing that that SD-WAN gives you the capability of doing, it doesn't do it automatically. As I said, automatically it does ECMP, but it gives you the ability to say any, let's say, voice traffic, any telnet traffic, any time-sensitive traffic, I want you to use the MPLS link to go out for any network. So I'm not linking MPLS to a route. I'm linking it to what? A particular type of protocol. So you can do it based on a protocol rather than a network, which is a much better factor rather than doing it based on a network, because network, you can have different type of applications and your requirements of latency, delay, those type of factors are not based on a network. They're based on applications. But in today's day and age, we're doing it strictly based on networks. All right? So now you have the ability to do based on application. You can do it with PBR using IP-based, but you cannot do it based on layer 7 characteristics. Let's say you have a web application. There are two types of web applications. Let's say web WhatsApp versus another application like a normal website. So in that, you would not be able to do it based on an application aware. You cannot say chats go this way like a normal website go that way. You get my point, John? So it's actually checking layer 7 characteristics, not just port numbers. Is the OMP specific feature? It is specific to SD-WAN. NBAR, it has an NBAR engine in there. So in order for LA to reach Rome via MPLS, it needs the MPLS cloud to know the reachability, correct. That is correct. So IP reachability needs to be there. Not necessarily a default route will do the trick, right? In terms of the public-private IPs, Zaidi, I will show that to you when we do the actual implementation. Any type of transport, as long as I have reachability, without any public IP, yes, without any public IP can still do it. I'll show you how the VBON helps in that. That's where the VBON helps, because when the device comes up, it needs to go and register to where? Where's the first place I told you when a WAN edge comes up, it needs to go to VBON to register. At the time it registers, it puts the public and private IP in that communication. So the VBON knows the public IP as well as the private IP. So even if it's changed, because as I said, as soon as the WAN edge comes up, where's the first place it needs to go? It needs to go to VBON. And if VBON finds that information and tells vSmart and vManage both the public IP and the private IP. And I'll show you that. It's a fantastic product. You will love it once you see the actual implementation of it. You guys understand what I'm trying to tell you over here in terms of the power of the policies. So now you can do policies, you can do routing by looking at the flow, the application flow, rather than looking at a network and doing routing. Well, that's a lot of people now are doing that. The good and the bad of it. The good thing about that is you have less people that you need to implement this. So you, what's the collateral damage that happens over here? They get rid of engineers. You have less engineers doing the job of more engineers because you can do it centrally. You get my point. So that's where they save the money to do it. But the thing is, that's where I think you guys are ahead of the game, because if you guys know this, you're that one guy or two guy which might get a raise and do this. You have the ability, if you want to, NBAR engine is built into VH to allow you the ability to do that. A lot more than DMVPN, Arshad. I've been doing DMVPN for 20 years. This is a lot more than DMVPN. You cannot even imagine doing these type of things in DMVPN. There are other vendors that have the similar type of architecture. They're not a lot, but there are other vendors that do it as well. It is an open standard, but it depends on how deep you go into it. Depend is too strong of a word. Depend means it will not run without it, right? It's an option. And that option is built in into the edges. You will see all those type of things, what happens when you change it. That is correct. That's where you need to get a more powerful device to be able to do it in terms of resources. Abu Bakr, that's right. I wouldn't compare it to DMVPN. A better comparison is to a type of technology that used to exist called IWAN from Cisco, which they basically, once they acquired Viptela, they just scratched that program. But that is what it is. It's IWAN on steroids. We'll talk about that when we get to that point. All right, in terms of what are the VHs. So far, you guys are okay with the overall understand. The reason I went through this in detail, because I want you guys to understand this is the power of SD-WAN. Centralized policies and centralized templates. All these changes that I told you about, whether I want to pick one route versus the other, everything is done based on the centralized policies on vManage. You don't need to go to any site to be able to do that. Is it right to say that even vBond is configured from vManage? Certain things, yes, absolutely. VHs are VM and physical. I'll get to that. Let's not jump. Good so far? The next thing that I want to talk about is the centralized troubleshooting and monitoring. I have all these devices over here. Everything, all the different characteristics in terms of routing, checking the routing table, checking the traffic analysis of that particular link, all can be managed from vManage. I don't need to do anything on this device. I can be sitting over here checking the routes over here, not only checking the routes. It also gives you a whole bunch of different management or monitoring tools in which, by default, the devices run a protocol by the name of BFD. BFD, on a regular basis, sends probes to check the status of the link. What is the round trip time? What is the delay? What is the latency it's getting on a particular network from point A to point B? And it reports that to vManage. So vManage knows the health of a particular link. So sitting on one place, basically BFD does that to figure out the hello packets, how long are the hello packets coming back in. So based on that, the vManage has a very clear indication of the health of a particular link. You get my point. So to monitor or maintain your entire network, you don't need to go and do it on each and every device. Everything can be done from a central location. All right. What can be on the same device? The controllers. Controllers are VMs. Remember what I told you, these are not physical devices. These are all VMs. Now, if they're VMs, you can install all of them onto what? One ESXi server, but these are three different entities. You get my point. So they're not physical devices. They're only virtual devices, but they can be put, they should be generally are put on the same ESXi server. Three separate VMs though. It's not a single VM, they are three separate VMs. BFD is done on all the different devices to maintain connectivity, including the data paths. Once the data paths are set up, it will keep on doing a BFD between the data sets. They're the default parameter. You can also change it if you want to. They're default parameters, or you can set your own. No BFD is done over IPsec. KVM and ESXi is what it supports. Nope, it is run over the IPsec tunnel, so the SP is not aware of it. All right, let's move on to the next one. So vManage, we basically are okay with. You guys are okay with everything over here. You understand this. And trust me, at the end, you'll understand everything, but one step at a time. The next one is vBond. Did I skip vSmart or no? No, vManage, vBond. What was the purpose of vBond? Authentication plane, right? Management is done by your vManage. That is correct, Wilson. We'll see that later on. So it is the authentication plane. What do I mean by the authentication plane? It is the one that makes sure a device is allowed to kind of come in into the network. Let's focus on the topic. I will get to that as well. You guys are okay with this. You understand what the vBond does, right? It is the device that the WAN edges initially will log into. The only address that you need to configure on the WAN edges is the IP address of vBond. You do not configure the vManage address. You do not configure the vSmart address on the WAN edges. The WAN edges only need to be aware of where is the vBond. Why? That's where they need to log into. The vBond will tell them about the vManage vSmart. It will also find out their information so it can also tell vManage and vSmart the IP addresses, both the public and the private IP addresses of the WAN edges that are logging in. If the WAN edges changes their IP address, again, as I said, it basically constitutes a re-login or reboot. It will again go back to the vBond and say, hey, listen, I want to authenticate. I just had an IP address change. Could you please authenticate me and tell me what the vManage vSmart addresses are? And then it sets the relationship up again. All right. Now, how is the authentication taking place? Let's understand that. It is done based on certificates. So I'm going to deviate from the SD-WAN topic to certificate-based authentication in general. Certificate-based authentication. In certificate-based authentication, you have a device that wants to communicate to another device. Device one and device two. They want to communicate to each other, but they want to communicate to each other having certainty they're talking to the right guy. How does device one know it is actually communicating to device two? It is done by using certificate-based authentication, in which I create my identity, including my name, my org, maybe the town, city, and all that type of stuff. I put that in over here, and I send this information to a device that everybody trusts, which is called a certificate server or a certificate authority. This request, where I'm telling the certificate authority, listen, my name is this, my organization is that, my city is this, this is called a certificate service request. Or a CSR. Let's forget that for right now. I'll go back to vBond. Okay, those questions will be answered. Follow what I'm talking about right now, Sundar. I will answer those questions. Just hang in there. So CSR is sent to what? The certificate server. Certificate server receives a request. He will verify the information, and the information is put in the format of an identification card, which is called the ID cert. It's basically the same information that I had over here, name or city. I put the same name, same city, whatever information you gave it, but he authenticates that, puts it in the form of an ID card, like a certificate, and signs it. Digitally signs it and sends it back to him. Understood, guys? Everybody okay with this? So now this guy, Dev2, has an ID cert signed by the CA. Good. It will also download the certificate for the CA that I can use to set this process up. It is a manual process in case you're doing it through your own certificate server. I'll explain that as well. Let's do this for generic right now. So yes, it is a manual process. So once I get the signature over here. If somebody else sends me that certificate, I need to verify the signature. How do I verify that this certificate that was issued is coming from the proper certificate server? For that, the signature of the CA server can be verified by a certificate for the CA server. That certificate is known as the root certificate. So the root certificate is whose certificate? It's a CA certificate. Agreed? Got it? Everybody okay with this? So now this guy gets a root certificate over here. This root certificate is used for what? Used to verify other certs. This guy over here will do the same exact thing. He will send his information. This was dev two, this is dev one. Sends it here. He validates it, sends it back over here. Okay? Once he gets back, what does he get back? What does he have now? He will also have two certificates. He will at least have his own ID cert. And he will have the root. Agreed? You guys understand that? So every device, if you want to do certificate-based authentication, will need to have at least one root and one ID. Can I have multiple roots? Absolutely, I can have multiple roots. These are called trusted roots or trusted CA servers. And this download, you can do it manually, or there's certain ones, certain devices that have this automatically done. These trusted root certificates basically mean if I get a certificate that comes in, which has a signature by any of those trusted root certificates, I trust that the device is the right device that I need to communicate to. You get my point? So yes, you need to manually download that certificate if it's a brand new device. Good so far, guys? Everybody okay with this? So what's the end result over here? So now your WAN edges and your V-bond. V-bond will have what? Its own ID cert. And it'll have the root cert. This guy, the WAN edge, needs to have its ID cert and the root cert. Agreed? So when I go to the WAN edge, I configure it with the IP address of what? V1 manually. I go onto this device, I do what is known as a skinny configuration where I give it IP address and the address of the V-bond. As soon as I do that, what does this guy try to do? He will try to contact this guy and he'll say, I am WAN Edge 1. And when he says, I am WAN Edge 1, I'm not going to say I'm WAN Edge 1. How do I say I'm WAN Edge 1? This information is in my ID cert signed by whom? By the CA server. What does this guy do? This guy will check whether that certificate is valid or not by comparing it to the root certificate. Check the signature. So what does that tell V-bond? This is the right guy. This is authenticated. Trust it. But at the same time, he will also challenge him saying, hey, listen, I want to talk to you, but could you please identify yourself? So what does the V-bond also need to do? The V-bond needs to send his certificate saying what? His ID cert. I am V-bond. Okay? I'm the V-bond. He will need to authenticate that using the root certificate. And that's what sets up the mutual authentication. Good? Now, how do I get these certificates? How did I get this ID cert? How did I get the root certificate? I'll just go through a quick process of making you understand that. And that's why I want you guys to hang into the question, because I need to talk about it anyways. I go into tangent when you ask those questions ahead of time. So that's why I say, please be patient. If I don't answer your question, then ask. So how does the V-bond get its certificate? The way it happens is on VManage. First thing that you do, let's say I'm using my local enterprise CS server, so I can set up my own local CS server. I set a relationship up between VManage and the CS server. I will download the root certificate of my CS server. I will generate my own ID cert manually over here. Sorry, I will generate my information, send the CSR to the CS server manually, and he will generate what for me from the CSR? ID cert, and send it back. So what does a vManage have right now? It has the ID and the root certificate for the CS server. Everybody okay with this? So that's the first process. The first process is to set up a relationship between what? The CS server and vManage. And how do I do it? I download the root. I generate my CSR. I get my ID cert. Good. So I got the ID cert over here. This process is done. Good so far, guys. Everybody okay with this? Now, the next thing that I will do is I will get my VBON registered. How do I get the VBON? The certificate service request emit. Remember, I talked about I generate my information, send it to my CS server, and the CS server takes that information, puts it into a certificate, sends it to me as an ID cert. Now, once this is done, I will then log in into my vManage and point towards my VBON. And when I do that, I will specify the IP address of VBON. I'll specify the username and password, the admin username and password. So that basically what I'm saying is this VBON I'm the administrator for because I'm providing the credentials to log in. As soon as I do that, my VBON gets inventoried into my vManage. So now in vManage, I have a pointer towards what? VBON. Good so far, guys? So this is a manual process. Everything that I'm doing is manually, and I'll show you one step at a time how to do this. So once a VBON is there, now I can, and as soon as the VBON comes in, first thing that happens, as soon as the VBON comes in, this root certificate is automatically downloaded. I'll speak about that. Let me finish this. Automatically downloaded over here. So he has the root certificate already. All done from vManage. I'm not doing anything from VBON. All the configuration is done from vManage. So on the vManage, as soon as I add the VBON, it will download the root certificate to VBON. Good? Everybody okay with this so far? Now, once this is done, I will go to vManage and I'll point to vManage and say, I want to generate a CSR for VBON. So I'm sitting on the vManage, I click on the VBON and say, I want to generate the CSR for this VBON. The CSR is generated for VBON, the vManage. I will go to CA manually, send the CSR over here. The CA will issue me what? An ID cert. And the ID cert will come in and I will install it on the VBON, which will push it down to this guy. So how am I getting the certificate, the root certificate and the ID cert for VBON done? It's all done through what? Through vManage. So VBON does not require access to the CS server, correct? So you're doing all of that through what? Vmanage. Everybody okay with that? So I'm not actually doing the configuration on VBON. I'm doing it for the VBON from vManage. Absolutely correct. It generates the CSR itself, and you'll see that. So everybody okay with the VBON certificate, the root and ID cert that I talked about? How do I get it on the VBON? But now the next thing is, how do I get it on the Okay, how do I get it on the VManage? The first thing, that again, it will go and do it based on the VManage. VManage is managing the entire thing. It has a smart tunnel with the VBON, the DTLS tunnel. So now the VManage, how do I do it on the VManage? On the VManage again, first thing that I need to do is set up the basic IP configuration so it can communicate on the network. Once I've done with that, I need to manually download and trust the root certificate. How do I do it? What procedure do I have? To download the root certificate, I can use any type of transfer mechanism. Like what? SFTP, SCP, any of those protocols you have, TFTP, all those, you can download the certificate where? Onto the flash of the VManage. And once you download it, you need to install it. So it's a two-step procedure. One, to get the file downloaded over here, not on the WAN edges. Downloading of the root certificate is done automatically on your controllers, not on the edges. I'll explain why that was the case. Where do I download the root certificate? No, I need to, it's a file. The root certificate is a file, a CER file or a PEM file. You put it onto your SFTP server or your SCP server and you download it from there. Remember I said it's from using this protocol. It's from, you copy that file. I'll show you that it's a file that you generate on your CS server. They'll give you that root certificate file. You put it onto your SFTP server or your SCP server and you download it. So now this file is where? On your WAN edge. Good so far, guys? This is just the root. This is not your what? This is not your ID cert. IP connectivity. Put an IP address on the interface, put a default route or a route so that it can communicate to the headquarter or wherever data center, wherever your device is, to your controller. IP address, default gateway, basically that's all you need. Good. Now I have the root certificate for the CA server. I need to get the ID cert. That process is automatic. What happens is on the way, I need you to register. Where does it go to register? To your V-Bond. When you go to register, you need to specify an authentication mechanism, which has two very important elements. One is called the chassis number and an OTP that Cisco has given you for the license. That's your initial authentication. Because at this point, I don't have an ID cert. I don't have it. So how do I authenticate against the V-Bond? Because I don't have an ID cert. I'll send this chassis number and OTP number. This chassis number and OTP number is something that would have been configured on your vManage, and vManage would have sent that chassis number and OTP number to your V-Bond. And in order to register, the vManage would have told the administrator of the WAN edge, what is the chassis number and the OTP number? So the vManage automatically, using its relationship with V-Bond, will download what? Valid, these are called valid WAN edges, to the V-Bond, which has the same chassis ID and OTP, that's the password that Cisco has given you. And you manually put that into a command, what your chassis number and the OTP number is, and you request a validation based on like a pre-shared key type of thing. So when it goes to the V-Bond, V-Bond authenticates the chassis number and the OTP number. If it matches, what does the V-Bond now know? It is a valid device. How does it know it's a valid device? Because the vManage has told it this chassis number, OTP number combination is correct. It's not a CSV file, David. It's a VIPTELA file, .VIPTELA file. And there's two different ways to do it. I'll explain them to you. OTP can only be done once. So for this chassis OTP number, it's just once, right? But once I do it, I don't need it again. I'll show you why in a second. So once it's authenticated, this guy authenticates and sends what information to him? Yeah, this guy is authenticated. This is all good. What is he going to do now? He's going to tell him about the IP address of the vManage and the vSmart. Which configuration comes under skinny, the chassis number and OTP? It's a command that you type in. It's actually a command. It's more than a configuration. So when it goes to vManage, using this identifier, yes, he is valid. What vManage does, he takes that information that he's authenticating, he sends that information automatically to whom? To your CA. This is completely automatic. So the vManage is basically representing your WAN edge. It will get an ID cert issued and push the ID cert down to him automatically. Because I already have the root certificate that was downloaded manually, I will validate it and I am good to go now. So the vManage automatically will register the WAN edges to the CA server. So there's no direct relationship that I need to set up between the WAN edge and the CA server at all. So that part is completely automatic. The downloading of your root certificate is done manually. That is correct. The underlay is what I'm talking about. When I say IP connectivity, is the underlay that I'm talking about. Reachability from the WAN edge to the VBAN and the VManage. So basically, if you look at this diagram over here, guys, what do I mean by IP connectivity? Let's say this is a router that I have an MPLS cloud and an internet cloud point. I'm not configuring the entire router. I just need to have reachability. So I might configure the G01 interface over here with an IP address and a default gateway. That will get me to the internet. And my VBAN address, I'll say, is, in my case, it's 199.113. Say my IP address is 113. I'm going to send that information across over here to my VBAN over here. That's 199.113. And that's what I mean by IP connectivity. All these communication through the DTLS tunnel, correct. Good so far, guys? IP, just normal IP communication, Hunter. IP connectivity at this point, that's what the internet cloud requires. Can you NAT the VBAN? Is that what you're asking? You cannot NAT on the VBAN. If this guy needs to have public connectivity, correct? You can, but you need to have a one-on-one NAT. So let's say this is your NAT device over here, and this is a private IP. You can do a one-on-one NAT. As long as you don't do any PAC with it, it's absolutely okay. So internally, I might be 192.168.101.5. On the outside, I am 199.111. Static NAT. Absolutely. As long as I have reachability, it's absolutely okay. Absolutely will. Tunnel process is normal encryption mechanism that it uses. It uses the private and public key to encrypt, creates a session key to establish an encrypted tunnel between the two devices. Now, in terms of the configuration that I need to do on the WAN edge, can the internet and MPLS be multiple providers? I don't really care how I get from point A to point B. As long as I have reachability is all I care about. Can I reach, can I ping 199.111? So first thing over here on the WAN edge, what do I do? What's the first thing that I did over here? Skinny configuration. What do I mean by skinny configuration? IP, default gateway, right? Basic configuration. Don't even think about it being a WAN edge. Think about it being a device that needs to communicate to this IP address on that is available on the internet. Good so far. Number two, what's the next thing that I did? Download the root. Install. Clear so far? This is on the WAN edge. I'm not talking about the VBAN. We did the VBAN already. Once this is done, what do I need to do next? Once I install it, register to VBAN. Using what? Chassis and OTP. And as soon as that happens, it the VBAN, which has the chassis and OTP, where did the VBAN get the chassis and OTP combination? From VManage. And where did VManage get that chassis and OTP from? They get that from Cisco. No, this chassis and OTP is Cisco's license. To authenticate that this WAN edge is a proper WAN edge. Smart account using PNP, absolutely correct. So you go to Cisco and say, I want to buy licenses for 5 WAN edges. Okay, they will provide you the chassis and the OTP for 5 WAN edges. And you install that in your what? In your WAN edge, that file, it's a .viptela file, or you could actually directly connect up from VManage into your Cisco smart account and download it directly. You can either do it manually or you can directly log into your smart account and download it over there. That you need to ask your local partner. You guys okay with this? When I do this, the fourth step is where I establish the DTLS. No, when you request for the license, you need to specify what type of device are you getting. Are you getting a V edge, which is a Viptela edge? Are you getting a C edge, which is your CSR router? Or you also have the ability to specify your ISRs and ASRs. So you have to tell them you have 5 V edges or 2 V edges, 2 C edges. You need to specify the type. Can a separate Cisco account purchase licenses for the WANs in their own budget? Yes, you can. You can create multiple organizations under your account. So when you go to the PNP portal, I'll send you a document if you want that shows you what you need to do on the PNP portal to get licenses. I think you are overdoing the IP part. I want to connect a device to the internet. All right, Mats? Forget about WAN Edge. I want to connect a device to the internet. What do I need to do to that device? I need to give it an IP and connect it to the internet, right? I can even do it based on DHCP, connect the device to the internet connection. IP, subnet mask, default gateway. Basic configuration. Forget about it's a WAN Edge. I want to connect a device to the internet. How would you do it? You understand or no? Just basic IP connectivity to the internet so I can reach the other side. You can even do it through DHCP. Maybe your WAN Edge does not have a static IP. So what do you do? You configure this interface with what? DHCP. So what does it do now? It gets an IP address and a default gateway. So can it communicate to Cisco.com at this point? Can it ping Cisco.com or ping Google.com? Absolutely can, right? So if it can ping that, it can ping the VBond, which is public address. That's what I want. I need to be able to reach the VBond. VEdge is a Viptela device. CEdge is your Cisco CSR. This is Viptela, the original vendor for SD-WAN, and CEdge is your CSR. When the vManage sends his certificate saying, I'm the vManage, how do I verify that this vManage is the right vManage? I need to use the root certificate to verify that this vManage is the right vManage. Not only that, I need to authenticate the vBond. I will need to do it based on that. That is correct, David. Those are the four steps that I need. And my at this point, my WAN Edge is inventoried in. You need to have reachability to your vBond. Then you need to do it manually, correct. If you don't have a DHCP configuration, you do it manually. My bottom line is you need to make sure that you have the ability to reach your VBond. Nope. Cisco CSA cannot, ASA cannot act as a VH. There are four devices that can act as a VH. And we'll talk about there's the Viptela VH, which could be either a VM or it is hardware. CEdge, which is just a VM. There's an ISR, hardware, and ASR, hardware. The difference between them is the processing power. These are the four WAN edges that you can have that can act as your Viptela advantages. All right, so let's take a look at where we're at now. I think you guys take a look at it and see if you guys are okay with this. What is the purpose of the VBond? Authentication device. It makes sure that the device, when it comes up, is authenticated properly. And in order to do that, it uses the certificates to do that. We had a detailed discussion about the certificates as well over here. Good so far, guys? Everybody okay with this? The next thing is vSmart, and we'll do the vSmart and we'll take a break after that. Purpose of vSmart, what does it do? The control plane, exchanging of the routes, the OMP routes is done by the vSmart. Who does it talk to? It does need to talk to the vManage and vSmart. Why? The authentication, once a WAN Edge authenticates, it needs to tell the vManage and vSmart that these are the valid authenticated devices. Good. Once that's done, it needs to communicate to vManage because vManage is the one that does all the configuration, pushes it down to the vSmart, including policies and the routing functionalities. And then it establishes an OMP tunnel to whom? To your what devices? The VEdges, the WAN Edges. I don't want to call them VEdges because VEdge is specifically for what? For your Viptela Edges. It does talk to the VBond. Remember, who has that chassis list? It's the vManage. No, initially it's on the vManage, right? vManage needs to tell the VBond, hey, listen, this is the valid chassis list. Not only that, once the WAN Edge authenticates. He authenticates against VBond. What does the VBond need to tell the WAN Edge? Hey, listen, this is your vManage. It also needs to tell vManage this is your WAN Edge. Introduces the both. the only one that you really need to have accessible over the internet is your V-Bond. Why? Once the initial authentication takes place with the WAN edges, the V-Bond knows the private and public addresses of your V-Smarts, your V-Manages, and your WAN edges. So it will tell everyone the public and private addresses. So it knows the private and public addresses of each device. Understood, George? So it is responsible for doing that. So in reality, the only one that you need to have publicly accessible is the V-Bond. The rest of the configuration is discoverable. And once we do the lab, you'll see that. You'll see the public and private address. I have a specific lab that I do just for that. Let me see, where's that? See this lab over here? I purposely put one of the devices behind firewall to do the NAT portion, so I can show you that this V-Edge, which is NATed, how does that register? You'll see a public and private address over there. One, does the authentication continue after the initial authentication based on the chassis and OTP? Once that's done, what happens is that the vManage will install the ID cert on the V-Edge. And from that point on, it will do the authentication based on the ID cert. The OTP chassis is just an initial authentication just to get it out. So V-Bond needs to be publicly reachable. The rest of them, they don't. They need vManage and V-Edge. Correct. And how do I know what the addresses are? The V-Bond will tell me what the addresses are. It will tell me what the private and public address for each device is. That's the responsibility of V-Bond.